haven't seen them in like 2 months.
My whole future is in Tom's hands. Are we ready? Okay. We need to get started this morning, folks. We got a real full morning coming up here, so if you could kind of find your places a little bit. I want to start off with a scripture from Isaiah 52. Therefore, my people will know my name. Therefore, in that day, they will know that it is I who foretold it. Yes, it is I. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, you, your watchmen, lift up their voices. Together they shout for joy. And we're going to do that this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we can be in your house on this Sunday morning. I know a lot of people in the world do not have the freedom to just enter a building as freely as we do here in the United States and here in Florence. And we don't want to take for granted the opportunity we have just to walk into this building whenever we feel like it. And so we thank you that we can be here. We thank you for our guests that are here, Lord. And we just commit this entire service into your hands. And we just want to hear what you want us to hear today. And everything we do here, Lord, is an offering of praise and an offering of worship to you. It's all about you. It's not about us. It's all about you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. Some of you have known me for a little while, whether you want to or not. And we're going to start our service this morning in a most unconventional way. Now, don't hate me. Just go with the flow, would you? You know what? There are atheist organizations in this country that are trying to drive Christianity out of the public square. And they're trying to drive Christianity out of the military. But you know what? It's not working. Would you stand with me this morning? And the words are not going to be on the screen, but I think you know the song. You're going to want to watch these guys. If you want to do the motions with them, you go right ahead. You're going to see grown young men in the Marines. I was just waiting for that. Do motions to songs like we did when we were kids in Sunday school singing songs. Roll it, guys. Sing along.
These are the days of Elijah. Yes, God like Jehovah. There is no 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 God like Jehovah.
Stay standing. When I see guys jumping up and down saying there's no God like Jehovah, I'm saying go Marines. Go Marines. Those atheist organizations can try to take Jesus out all they want. It is not going to work. Amen. It is not going to work. Those guys love Jesus. And they're not embarrassed at all about doing motions. I think that is really cool. I saw that. Did everybody hear that?
Who did
that? He said the streets of heaven are guarded by United States Marine Corps guys. Yeah.
Who did that?
I don't know about that, but I'm not going to argue with Richard. So we're really glad to have Cal and Denise back. They went on a trip clear to Minnesota, and I appreciate Cal and Kurt working upstairs and Denise and Susie down here. They're going to lead us in one more song before we do some announcements. Go ahead, ladies.
It's time for the reign of God. It's time for your lights to shine. It's time for
Time for you to sit down. That's what it's time for. Couple things that I need to run by you just really quickly. This coming Saturday is our semi-annual oil change for the cars of single moms here in our community. It's an outreach ministry we do. We've got a lot of people signed up. I could use a few more guys. If anybody has time between 9:30 and 12:30, we could use a couple more. Maybe. We never know how busy we're going to be. But we're getting publicity out. We put an ad in the paper, and we want to serve lower-income moms in our community that don't have the money to get their oil changed. And some of them, we can tell, we're the only oil change they ever do. We can tell by the kind of filter we put on. We see them every 6 months, and it's a great outreach ministry to the community. So if you can help with that, bring a socket set if you have it. Okay? I'm not talking about your elbow socket, okay? Or your knee socket. You know. Socket wrenches. Oh, those things. Yeah, I see. I'm not really mechanically inclined. But anyway, that will be a great ministry. And Tom has something he wants to share.
I'll try to be quick. Once a year, I have the opportunity to bring into town one of the top 100 estate planning lawyers in the nation. Eden Rose Brown will be here in coordination with a number of churches in town that are coordinating this. It'll be held over at Crossroads next Saturday from 10 to 2. 50% of the people in this state do not have even a will. She'll talk about very, very interesting and entertaining details about trust and estate planning so that what you own can do what you want after you're gone. She'll talk about things you've never heard about. There'll be food, and I promise it is an entertaining, very enlightening, out-of-the-box presentation. If you are interested, you can call me. I'm in the church directory. You can reach me through the church office here. I'm trying to get to a number of people involved in terms of attending, so I know how many people to plan on for food and other things. It's just part of the services that I provide in my job. I have no skin in the game, but Eden works with our Oswego office, and she's willing to come down and work with me once a year here in Florence to help people, and she's seeing a number of people from our last meeting to finalize their trust and estate planning. So if it's something that you're interested in talking to me about, give me a call. Thanks.
Okay. I think that about covers it. We want to welcome those who are watching on the internet. We're glad to have you with us this morning. And I think we're ready for the ushers. If you have a prayer need, be sure and fill it out on the back of this tab and just... like that, and we'll pray for those in our staff meeting. So ushers, let's come and receive our morning offering. We're going to sing one more song before we pray, and then I'm going to introduce our special guests. Thank you, Father, so much that we can be in your house on this wonderful Sunday morning. We give back to you our tithes and offerings. Lord, it's a joy to give back to you. It is not an obligation. It is a responsibility, but it's something we do with joy. Because you've given so much to us, we want to give back to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church. I need, before we go to prayer this morning, I need the members of the church board to come up here real quick. Come quickly. Come. Quickly. Well, I didn't say you had to run. Where's everybody else? Denise is here. Some of them are gone today. I just wanted to present to them, and a bunch of you helped, but I can't get everybody up here. But the church board is really the ones that made this happen. And their spouses. And I was called to the fire chief in our community. His name is Jim Langborn. And he called me on Friday and said, I got something for you. And I said, I'll come by your office and get it. And I went into his office, and he gave me this card. It says Sioux Valley Fire and Rescue on it, signed by many, not all, but many of the firefighters that came to our first responders dinner that we did here. I don't know if everybody knows, but we did a barbecued tri-tip dinner for all the first responders in our community in this room, a couple weeks ago? And they also, hold that please, Doug. And they also, the fire chief also gave me the certificate of appreciation presented to the Church of the Nazarene for your support and generosity for the dinner that we did for them. So the firefighters really appreciate, and we invited some police and ambulance. A few of them came. Most of the people that were here were firefighters. But I just wanted to publicly thank the board and your spouses for helping us out, and for all of you that brought food and cheered in the foyer as they walked through and cheered for them. We appreciate that so much. The firefighters really do appreciate it. And because, hold that too. You're good. Because of our budding friendship between me and the fire chief, I'm not sure I'm qualified to do that, but they're going to hire a full-time firefighter. And he said, Brian, you need to be on the interview committee for that. And I said, name the time and the date, and I'll be there. And I'll come and be a part of that. And I'm not quite sure why he's asking me, but that's very nice of him to do that. And I am trying to build a friendship with the fire chief and some of the firefighters here in town. And I think... Okay, well, whatever. Okay, so you guys can have a seat. Thank you. Here, I'll take them back. So we want to pray this morning before our guests come and speak to us. And we need to pray for things both here at home and around the world. People continue. If you watch the news, you know this. People in Iraq and Syria continue to be killed for their faith. The ISIS people are executing a lot of Christians. And that has continued to happen recently, even this past week. You're gonna talk about that, aren't you? You're going to talk about it. You may hear more about this. But actually, there's significant revival and spiritual awakening going on in parts of the Muslim world. You're not going to read about it in the paper. You're not going to hear about it on Fox News or CNN or NBC or CBS, ABC, because they don't even know about it. I don't even know if they want to know about it. And I'm not sure that we want them to know about it. But revival is happening among the Muslim world. When you see people beheading children, is that a kind of a religion you want to be associated with? A lot of people say, I don't want anything to do with that. That's just brutal. That's just nasty. So we need to pray for people there. We need to pray for Juanita Kilpatrick. She's got some severe medical issues. I will not go into the details. That's her personal business. But they are severe. They are very severe. And we need to continue to pray for Wanda May. And I know there's other things going on in your lives. I know there is. I know some of them. I don't know some of them. But let's stand for prayer. If you're able to stand this morning, let's stand for prayer. And come before the Lord. And you know, folks, I don't know why certain things happen. I don't know. I'm not smart enough to figure all that out. I don't think anybody is. But we put stuff in God's hands. We say, God, you're the master, you're the Lord of the universe. And you're in control. Father, we thank you this morning for all the blessings of our lives. America's got a lot of problems right now. Man, it's a country that in some ways is drifting away from you. And yet we have so many blessings. Lord, we want to be a mission station right here in Florence, Oregon. We need mission stations by the thousands all over the United States. And not just of the Nazarene Church, Lord. I'm not sure I really care what denomination they are. If they're preaching Jesus and a born-again life with Jesus. And I know a lot of churches are doing that. I pray that churches would do that right here in Florence this morning. Lord, we pray for Juanita and Wanda. They're going through some challenging and difficult things, Lord. And we lift them up to you and pray that you would be working in their lives. We pray for our brothers and sisters around the world, Lord, people that we will never see this side of heaven. People are dying for their faith every day. And I can't even begin to express how much I appreciate or admire people that will not back down. They will not recant their faith. They will not give up Jesus, and they'll die. And they have, and they are. And we pray that out of the blood of martyrs, Lord, as I pray almost every week, that that great spiritual awakening would rise up and move like a low tsunami wave through the Muslim world. It won't get a lot of publicity, and I'm not sure we want it to. But it'll change hundreds and thousands, tens of thousands of life, and we pray that that would happen, oh God. That would people would realize that there is no hope with Islam. There's no assurance of heaven with Islam. They have to work their way and to heaven, and then they don't even know for sure if they're going to get there. I pray that they would discover the hope and the love of Christianity. And the hope and the love and the mercy and the grace and compassion of Jesus. And I pray that it would be life-changing. And I do pray that it would spread like a low wave through the Muslim world across North Africa and the Middle East and Indonesia and South Asia, Lord, where there's so many Muslim countries. Oh, God, do a mighty thing. Do a mighty thing in Syria, Nigeria, Lebanon, Iraq, Iran. Do a mighty thing in Florence, in Oregon, and across the United States. God, use us, we pray. Lord, I pray that you'd bless as we do the oil change this Saturday, that it would be an outreach to single moms in this community. And Lord, we're trying to bless them in a positive, functional kind of way. And help us to make a difference. We pray for other churches today, Lord. We pray for the Florence Evangelical Church. Thank you for Rob Griffiths, and he's such a good friend with we are such good friends. And I just thank you for his church. Help him today, Lord. I know he's preaching Jesus. I know he is. May they see lives changed and great things happen. May they be a powerful lighthouse in this community, Lord. We pray for our Nazarene church up in Hillsboro, Lord. Bruce McCrite, he's relatively new there. I don't know him. Doesn't matter, Lord. Do a mighty thing through the Hillsboro Nazarene church out in that area out west of Portland, Lord. And it's a mission field there. It's a mission field here. Use this pastor, his staff, the wonderful people of his church to make a mighty difference for the kingdom of God in the greater Hillsboro area. Be with our district superintendent, Lord, Dr. Reeder, and his assistant, Bud Pugh, wherever they might be today, Lord, just use them in a powerful way. Lord, we thank you that we're a part of an international church. It's not just a district church. It's not just a nation church. It's an international church that reaches around the world into so many countries. And we're a team. Man, we may not meet a lot of members of the team in this life, but we're still a team. And we're so thankful that we can be a part of the team. We're just one little tiny part of it here in Florence. But every part is important because it all adds up to something significant. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Not you. You don't get to be seated. I said that. We have some special guests with us today, and I'm really excited about this. We do this about maybe twice, two, three times a year. Todd and Connie Aebischer are global missionaries with the Nazarene Church. They've been serving for 20-some years, give or take, whatever. They can tell you more about that. And they are based in the Asia-Pacific region, which is Asia and the Pacific. Duh! Brilliant, huh? Isn't that brilliant? They can tell you more about that. We're delighted to have them this morning. They're going to come share with us at this time.
All right. Hold on to that. Well, good morning. Good morning. Great to see so many out on a beautiful foggy day. We are loving this beautiful weather here in Florence. I just want to open, we can't ever pray enough. And I want to open in a word of prayer and then hang on to your seats because we've got some exciting stuff to share this morning. Father, thank you again for this time. Lord, thank you for your incredible blessings. Thank you for a church family that, Lord, no matter where we go, we have family. What a blessing that is. And so, Lord, we just come to you today and ask that this wouldn't be a time of just telling stories, that this wouldn't be a time of entertaining speech. Lord, this would be a time of challenge, of inspiration, of encouragement, of motivation. Lord, that each one of us would leave here changed today. Father, show us where you are working. Show us what you would have us to do, where you would have us to go. And Father, we will praise you as we seek revival, and we believe you are bringing it to this nation and around the world. Thank you, Father. In your name we pray these things. Amen. I will never forget the day that Dr. Russ Lovett called me and said, Todd, bring the airplane. You see, as mission aviators, we would fly all over Africa or the South Pacific, and missionaries would call us and say, we need a team or a doctor or this or that. Well, he called me one day in West Africa. He said, Todd, bring the airplane. We need to fly to Tanguieta. Tanguieta is a village up on the southern edge of the Sahara Desert, northern Benin. And I said, well, Dr. Lovett, what does the airstrip look like? When a missionary calls for an airplane, it's their job to do a little bit of research. And he said, well, I don't really know. I said, okay, that's all right. Dr. Lovett, is there any fuel up there? Do I need to bring extra fuel in the airplane, or do I need to have some trucked in, or what's the situation on fuel in that area of the world? And he says, well, I don't really know. Well, Dr. Lovett, there are rebels working in the southern Sahara region. This is not a really good place, and an aircraft is a high-dollar asset. We need to be cautious when we fly into this area. What's your intel tell you about rebel activity in the area? What do you think he said?
I don't know.
You know what I'm thinking at this point in time? I'm thinking, this guy, he's got a PhD after his name. I'm just a pilot. Is there anything that this guy does know? How do you get this PhD? But I was gracious. I didn't tell him that. He said, Todd, would you just bring the airplane? So I brought the airplane. I flew over to Cotonou, the capital city, and we loaded Dr. Lovett and his wife, and we started to fly for Tanguieta. And as we're going to Tanguieta, he starts to tell me the story. He says, you know, Todd, there's a guy up there who has a brother in the Ivory Coast, three countries away, and the brother got the manual of the Church of the Nazarene. And you know that when you give to World Evangelism Fund and you support missions, part of that is our translation of literature into almost 100 languages around the world. And so this manual had been translated into the local language, and he sent it to his brother up here in Cotonou, up on the edge of the Sahara. His brother got this and started reading it. You know, the holiness message of the Church of Nazarene resonates in the world of hardline religions, and I'll just put it there since we're being recorded today. In fact, a life change is very important for some of these religions. If you're going to follow a God, that God demands that life be different. And so when they read the holiness message of the Church of Nazarene, this man decided, you know, I'm going to build me one of these. And so he did. He started to make himself a church. But then he got down to that part in the manual that says it needs to be organized. Well, how do you do that? I need to call a missionary. So he called down the capital city and found Dr. Lovett. And so this is how we end up in an airplane going to a place no missionary has been, to a church we've never seen, to people we've never met, to organize a Church of the Nazarene. Well, I wished he'd done a little more research on the airstrip. I got up there, and it was a dirt airstrip. I'm so glad I learned to fly off a Buell airstrip, which is a little dirt airstrip down in White City, southern Oregon, and I learned how to fly in the backcountry of the Cascades. And so I used every bit of that backcountry experience to get that airplane on the ground, you know, around. You know, we have African potholes in this airstrip. Anybody know what an African pothole looks like? That, yes, deep. That is one you drive in one side and hope you come out the other. You know, in Africa, we have snorkels on our jeeps, and it's not uncommon in rainy season to be going by a pothole, and you look over and you just see a snorkel out the top. That's all that's left, you know. And, well, it was dry season, and I was able to get the airplane on the ground. It took me another day with my shovel to fill in enough of the holes to get the airplane back out again. That's a different story. They came and they picked us up in a little car and they hauled us up to this church at Tanguieta. And let me tell you, folks, they made these Marines look like they were just stoic. I mean, they are dancing and singing and celebrating. You know, one time in Africa, all the years we're in Africa, one time they asked me to get up and dance with them. I did. And they said, that white boy, he got no rhythm. And so they let me sit back down. And, you know, the rest of the time we would dance and celebrate. And they did. And they had such a great time. And then after we finished the formalities of the service, what do you have to do if you're Nazarene? Eat. You guys knew it, you know. We don't know the whole manual, but we've got that 900-something paragraph ... that says Nazarenes have to eat. It doesn't matter whether they are in Eurasia, North America, USA, Canada, Africa. You got to have a potluck, and you got to get everybody together. But I have never learned as a missionary to pray more fervently than I have at African potlucks. You know? Let me tell you, who can tell me the definition of an African potluck? Anybody know? Yes, whatever's in the pot, and you are lucky if you survive what's in the pot. That's why it's potluck, you know. I have never prayed like I prayed. You know, they love a delicacy up there. It's bush rat. And we're not talking bush mouse. We're talking they're long, and they got these long tails. And they like to boil it with the hair on. So you've got something to hang on to when you get the meat, you know, pulled off your teeth. Well, I never really learned to enjoy that African delicacy, but we ate it. And then they said, wait a minute, we've got to have a board meeting. Pastor, 23 years you've been here?
Yes.
Yeah, how excited do those beautiful gentlemen and ladies get about board meetings? They just get jumping up and down excited?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's so good to hear. Because, boy, they do out there. Let's have a board meeting. And they took us to the back of this church. This church had a Terabatu wall. Terabatu is red brick with straw that's baked, and then it had a tin roof over the top of it. And you realize that there were mornings when I landed up there at 9 o'clock in the morning, it was 127 degrees on my thermometer in the airplane. Now put yourself in a tin building. You feel like you're in one of those kilns, and you know, and you're the pot. You're the one getting cooked. And we got in there, and then we're having this board meeting. And they are so excited about what's going on with this new church. And so we're starting to pack things up after the meeting. They said, wait a minute, we've got some people we want you to meet. And we said, well, who's that? And they said, well, we have this NYI president and this NMI president. We've got this SDMI. And we said, oh, wait, we're tying them out. We just organized a church. Where did you get these people? And they said, well, the manual said we needed them. We elected them. We have no idea what they're really supposed to do. Can you? But here they are. Can you tell us? So we started to teach about what it is, NYI. Why do we focus on training up young people while they're still young, and giving them the tools they need? And what is SDMI and Sunday school? And what is NMI? Why is it important to mobilize the church for missions to take the message where it has not yet been? And we start to fold things up again, and they said, well, wait a minute. We've got some more people we want you to meet. We thought, who in the world now? And so we understand that you can issue local ministers' licenses. And we've got 7 young men that feel called to take the gospel, and can you issue local minister's license? So Dr. Lovett opens up his briefcase and pulls out some forms, and we issued 7 local minister's licenses there that day. This was 2003. You will not believe what God has done, but you're going to have to stay for the rest of the service to hear. You know? We have to have a cliffhanger, because I have some people like to escape early. Well, guess what? This is a mission service. And the first time Connie and I were in a mission service in Africa, it started at about 10 a.m. and it went and it went. And by about noon, we're looking at our watches. And 1 o'clock, we're looking at our watches. And 2 o'clock, it just keeps going. And I said, are they ever? You know, we realized that the nationals had it figured out. They were just going out into the bushes and doing their stuff and then coming back in. And Connie and I are going, this has got to get over soon, you know. And about 4 o'clock, they close the service and say, all right, folks, you've got about 45 minutes. Be back here for the Sunday school rally that starts. And so we went and grabbed a couple hot dogs. We came back, and they started the service again. And they ended up with this big pot, and the ones they used to cook missionaries in. You know, that's what I'm thinking of as I see them stirring it out there. And we have potluck, of course, you know. So at any rate, my thought here today is we don't have to be till North Bend until about 6 o'clock tonight. So you can just hang in there. This is a mission service. The watch is off now. The gloves are off. We got great stories to tell you. Asia-Pacific region. You know, in the structure of the Church of the Nazarene, you have six regions in the world. You've got North America, Canada, which you are a part. You've got Eurasia, Africa, South America, Mesoamerica, and the Asia-Pacific region. Now, I'm pretty proud of the Asia-Pacific region. That's our region. Because it extends from Australia and New Zealand in the south, the bottom of the world, all the way to the top to Mongolia, and all of, taking in all of China. We have all of the Pacific Islands, the Marianas, the Carolinas, Vanuatu, Fiji, and sweeps all the way west to the eastern borders of India. We have fully 2.7 billion people, 40% of the world's population, and 30% of the global land mass. 7,105 spoken languages that we know about, and that doesn't cover the people groups that we're just learning about. In February, I traveled down into the highlands of Papua New Guinea, and I am sort of an outback guy, raised in Oregon. I love the Pacific Crest Trail. If I've got a day off, you'll find me with a backpack, or I think I put in 11 miles or something yesterday or the day before. I'm just all over. If I can get out, I'll take an hour and walk. And so I said, I want to go in and see some of these tribal areas. And so I went as far as I could by Jeep and then by mission airplane to a mission strip, then put on my backpack and walked further to see some of these areas where they're still in loincloths, spears, bows and arrows, sticks through their nose. Unbelievable. And research tells us we have 44 people groups, tribal areas, that either by geopolitical reasons or personal decision, they are completely isolated from the world. That's just in Papua. Well, the Asia-Pacific region also has some of the most creative access areas. Those are the areas where if you go and try and share the gospel, you can be imprisoned or executed. We have restricted access areas where we are, but we still have to be fairly cautious about it. And today I want to take you on a tour of what God is doing. I want to start that tour in the Word, in Isaiah 43. If you have your Bibles, turn there with me. Isaiah 43, I want to start in verse 14. This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake I will send to Babylon and bring down as fugitives all the Babylonians and the ships which they took pride. I am the Lord, your Holy One, Israel's Creator, your King. This is what the Lord says, He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters, who drew out the chariots and the horses and army and reinforcements together, and there they lay, never to rise again, extinguished, snuffed out like a wick. You remember that story, right? Children of Israel being brought towards the promised land, being freed. He says in verse 18, forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? When I read that, the Lord shares or speaks to my heart, I am doing a new thing. Behold, it springs up. Do you not want to be part of it? And I'll tell you what, God is moving. And you, even though you're out here in Florence, are part of it. Because it's not just happening overseas across the ocean. It's happening right here in your communities. I want to start, though, and take you across the Asia-Pacific region to give you a little bit of idea of how God is moving there. And then I want to sort of bring it home. Because God has been working with Connie and I in the last year and a half in ways we could never have imagined. He has so turned our perspective on mission upside down that while we've been doing this for 21 years, we have not seen progress like we have seen in the last year ever before. I want to share with you as we end today what that is and encourage you along that line. But back to Asia. What's happening in Dianella, Perth, Australia? Part of my job as regional communications coordinator is to figure out what's working in places and then tell the rest of the church so they can figure out how to do it also. How is God moving? Or do you realize that on Asia-Pacific region, we have these things now. They're starting to come. North America, the rest of the world, growing use of mobile phone and technology at 7 to 12%. Asia-Pacific region now is growing at 37%. The Chinese market has opened. Malaysia, Indonesia, Korea. These things are taking our area by storm, and it is opening up a window of opportunity for us to be able to put the gospel message on these and get it out like never before. And so that's just one of the things. As communications coordinator, I work with a team of very incredibly talented folks in Manila, and we have a studio, and I'll share some of the things in video up here a little later. But in Dianella, on the west coast of Australia, Perth, it's a church that I went down to visit and meet the pastor, Tim Burton. And Tim said, Todd, he said, you're not going to believe what has happened to this church. He said it was dying out. It was a church that was completely gray. Everybody had their crowns of glory, and they were just waiting to go on to glory. He said, you know, we were sort of in this decline, and the church has been there for over 50 years, and I just knew that we had to do something. We had to reach out. And so they started praying, God, where would you have us to go? What would you have us to do? And in Australia, people can come from around the Asia-Pacific Rim, different nations, come to Australia to study, but they've got to learn English. And they've got to learn and pass an English exam fairly quickly. If they don't, their visas aren't good, they have to leave. So to get their student visa to stay, they've got to pass an English exam. So he said, you know, we could help some of those college students. And so they took their church and they started to reach out. And they had a potluck after every Sunday service. And they would bring students in and they would set tables like we have in the back, and they'd put an English speaker from the church with one of those students. And guess what happened? College students love to eat, especially when it's free food. Those kids started coming in, and they learned more than just English. They learned what it was like to be loved, to have somebody put an arm around them, to care about them. Well, they outgrew their Sunday program. They started going midweek, and they opened up a building downtown Perth, and they started meeting with folks in the midweek evening sessions. I got there with my video camera. It's a church about three-quarters the size of this room here, and I stood in the corner, and I panned across with my camera and just could not believe the number of ethnicities in this building. And they were singing and dancing, and the young families. And one of the ladies, I believe, that was probably there since Jesus walked on the earth, and she was definitely there since the church was started, I grabbed her after the service and I said, you've got to tell me about this. She says, you're not going to believe it. This is not the same church it used to be. It has changed so much, but it is so awesome. She said, we have new people coming to the Lord and all these young families. And she said, I just love it. She says, I can't teach English, but I can cook. And so she would bring food in. And folks, what we didn't see, an unintended or unanticipated outcome, is that when those students finish, they go back to where they came from. And they tell us that that Dianella church now is a light and a spark that is sweeping Australia, because students are going back to Sydney, they're going back to Brisbane, they're leaving and going back to Cambodia and Vietnam and China and different countries of the Pacific Rim, and they're taking the gospel and the church with them. Who could have ever imagined that that would be the outcome of a pastor and a Korean missionary who got together and said, we need to find out where God is working and we need to join him in it. But God is doing something incredibly new and exciting there. I want to take you up to Myanmar. Myanmar, formerly known as Burma. How many of you watched the video or the movie years ago, The King and I? Have you seen that? That was set in Burma. Because of years of the rule and political dictatorship, the borders were not open to Christian missionaries. But we had a man there by the name of Robin Seya. About 45, 50 years ago, Robin heard the gospel message. Robin was so moved, he asked the man for a Bible that shared the message with him. The man said, I don't have one. There's not one available here, but you can borrow mine for 10 days. 10 days, you give it back. And so he read that Bible, and he said, I knew I only had 10 days. I read it almost all day long. I took every note I could. Robin then decided he needed more training, and so he was able to slip from Kalemio, which is the city he lived in, on the border of India. He slipped over into India where there was a Bible school. And he went to Bible school for 4 more years. He finished, he came back to Burma. He met another man on a platform who was there teaching, and the man said, you know, Robin, you should get some more education. Convinced Robin to go to Fuller University in Southern California. Robin didn't know how he was going to get there. His family weren't believers and weren't supporting him, but he made his way there. He got there, the story of how he wasn't picked up, somebody put him on a bus, and he finally, I mean, it's amazing that he even survived his first 24 hours in Southern California. But he makes it to Fuller University, and he said, within the first week, I knew I was all by myself. I was an immigrant student. I hardly spoke the language. I had to find a church home. And so this, as I'm interviewing him this February on the border of India, I was there, and he's sharing his story. He says, now I need you to tell about the churches that weren't nice to me. I said, Robin, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go bash churches. He said, but they need to know. They got to shape up. I said, well, just keep telling me the story, Robin. He said, well, I went to this first church. I walked in. I was an immigrant student who didn't speak the language. I walked in the back, and they never even noticed me. He said, I walked back out. He said, I went to a second church. It was that way. I went to a third church, and nobody even paid me any attention. He said, and then I went to a fourth church, and I saw the sign. It said, Pasadena First Church of the Nazarene. He said, I remembered when I was in India, I read this little book. It was just a little quick read. It was in my local language. It said, what it means to be Nazarene. He said, and I remembered thinking, man, I ought to check this out. And so he went through the doors of Pasadena First Church. He said, Todd, it was like a magnet. He said, people just all over me and inviting me to dinner, and they loved on me. He said, there was a man there by the name of Harold King, and Harold has now since passed. But Harold came up and put his arms around me and said, welcome to our church. I will take you to every service you want to go to. I will be your adopted family. Robin told me, he said, I realized then and there, if that's what it meant to be Nazarene, I wanted to be that for the rest of my life. Robin finished his PhD at Fuller, made his way back over the borders into Burma, and this March, when I was there, we celebrated the 30th anniversary of the Church of the Nazarene with several thousand Nazarenes, many, many churches. We actually have the Myanmar Nazarene Bible College. Who would have ever believed that an immigrant student walking in the back door, loved on by a church, would end up opening a nation to the gospel? Do you think God had a plan there? Behold, I am doing something new. It will spring forth. Do you perceive it? Don't you want to be part of it? Yeah. I want to move us from Myanmar and Burma over to the Philippines. You'll remember watching the news that Super Typhoon Yolanda, hit the shores of the Philippines last November 8th. Connie and I were on the ground. It was, by now, research tells us, the Navy, the strongest tropical storm in the history of world record keeping ever to make landfall. Wow. There have been other storms, larger, more intense at sea, but they've broken up by the time they hit land. This one didn't. This one came ashore in the central Visayas region of the Philippines with forces equivalent to, they tried to tell me what it was like, and they said it's equivalent to a tornado sitting down on your house for 8 hours. The winds were in excess of 200 miles per hour. I was down there within just a couple days afterwards helping to facilitate the Nazarene response, and I saw buildings, concrete walls toppled. The rebar just bent. I saw what looked like somebody taking a weed eater and gone from the shores all the way to the ridgelines. I was in a helicopter. We're going to show you a video. I was in a helicopter within just hours, and we were trying to decide where we were going to go and how we were going to even begin to address this need. And from flying in the States and Oregon for several years, I flew in different capacities, but one of those years I flew as aerial attack and recon for the Forest Service. So, you know, I'm one of those invincible guys, they say. You know, no, you're just 21 and not smart. You know, they would put me in the air while the lightning strikes were still going down. This is before advanced technology, so I'm flying around the thunderstorms, looking for the smokes, you know, so I can then call in the reinforcements on the ground. And so I've seen burned out forests. And I remember as I crested the ridge in the Philippines in the helicopter and went down the eastern side, I remember what my mind said, man, they've had a forest fire here also. And then I realized, you know, recalibrate. They hadn't have a fire here. The wind was so intense that it defoliated and burned brown everything green from the shores to the ridgeline. I mean, you had a few green trees left, but otherwise things were just stripped and burned brown. This wasn't a tribal area. You know, a lot of times we think of developing worlds and we think of, well, it was just remote villages and those things happen. No, I stood in the Lexus dealership and shot pictures. I was in the Ford dealership with the upside-down Mustangs. I saw the blown-out Kentucky Fried Chicken and McDonald's and the heavy, huge four-store malls. This was a city of 1 million people, highly, highly developed. And they called it a death city. The bodies were buried in the rubbish. We had bodies stacked up in black bags. We had debris fields like this. And you know, we had 350 Nazarene congregations in that area. In the first hours afterwards, it was the Church of Nazarene that was first on the ground, because we had pastors there who were carrying their motorcycles across debris fields to find areas where they could drive on whatever was left of a road to go and give the reports. I'm going to show you up here, and you're going to see Nazarene disaster responders in blue vests. Our young guys and gals, 20-something years old, who started giving us the reports. We worked with the United Nations. You realize the Church of Nazarene is a group of integrity, and people recognize that. And just like the fire department recognizing Pastor, the church is recognized on an international level. International Relief and Development contacted us. Counterpart International contacted us. U.S. State Department. You're going to see a plane up here, FedEx. FedEx contacted us and said, we know what you guys do. We want to give you the largest cargo plane in our fleet. And you're going to see they gave that to us. We loaded it with over $3 million worth of medical supplies and relief, and FedEx flew it from Kansas City straight to the heart of the zone. Cost them $350,000 in fees and fuel to get that plane there, and they gave it to us for free because they said, we know you guys are going to make a difference. Something unique happened also on the ground. As I'm down and we're working with medical teams and using the medical training that I received at the university and helping coordinate, I start talking to people and they say, you know, you guys are strange. Well, as communications coordinator, my job is to figure out why we're strange. Tell me about it. Why are we strange? They said, because you love everybody. I said, yeah, well, that's what we're called to do. I said, no, you come in with your medical teams, and if you had a church, you didn't just take care of your church members, you took care of the whole community. You came in with food, and you didn't just feed your people. You fed people who didn't believe in God. You fed this religious group. You fed that religious group, and you loved everybody. You brought in building supplies, and you didn't just rebuild your church and your church members' homes. You gave that out to everybody. Why? I said, because we believe that as followers of Christ, we're to be his tangible hands and feet, and Christ loved everybody, regardless of where they were, at what point in their life. And that is what we're called to do as a church. And we have now churches planted in areas where we could have never gone before. If you want to Google something, Google the southern Philippines, area called Mindanao, and you can find out what goes on down there. We have churches there now because the Church of Nazarene was responsive to being the tangible hands and feet of Christ. I want to fire these three videos. They're one right after the other. The first video was shot within just hours after the storm hit. It was, together we can as a global church make a difference, every church around the world. The second one was, together we are now making a difference, shot within about the first week. You'll see me up there with bags under my eyes, worse than today, and just half dead because I was down in the zone. I would shoot the video, I would come up because there was no communications to transmit it. I'd drop it in our studio, change clothes, buy a whole new backpack full of equipment because I'd left my stuff with people that needed it, turn around, get on the next plane, fly to the closest point I could, get on an overnight ferry, go overnight on the ferry, get on an overland, and this is how we had to move teams in and out. And so a little bit tired, a little bit rugged. And then you'll see the third one of where we are now, a recent update from March of how the global church has made an impact and what a difference it is making in the lives of the people in the Philippines. Can we roll those three, please?
We've all heard about the devastation Typhoon Haiyan brought.
$760 million worth of property damage.
More than 800,000 families displaced.
More than 2,000 lives lost.
It's time that we help.
It's time that we rebuild.
It's time that we give hope.
Let's be the hands and feet of Christ.
Together as one.
Together as one.
Together as one.
Together as one.
Together as one, we can.
We can.
We can.
We can.
And we can.
We can.
We can.
We can.
We can.
We can.
Together as one, we can.
Thank you.
this storm is Sandy size in width.
Warmest greetings from the Philippines. On November 8th, Super Typhoon Haiyan, locally known as Yolanda, reported to be one of the most powerful storms to ever make landfall, changed the landscape and lives of the central Philippines in unimaginable ways. In the aftermath of this unprecedented natural disaster, the response of the Global Church of the Nazarene has also been equally unprecedented. From Cuba to Canada, the Middle East to Eastern Asia, well over $4 million have been provided through gift-in-kind partnerships and actual funds raised. More than 200 volunteers have been at work here in the Philippines with countless others around the world, preparing and delivering relief goods, providing medical support, psychosocial counseling and training, and most importantly, praying for this global response. Because of your continued giving to the World Evangelism Fund, the Church of the Nazarene already had significant infrastructure in place, which allowed us to provide almost immediate response and to become a major on-the-ground facilitator for many other international agencies. As of March 1st, the equivalent of 13 40-foot containers of relief supplies have been distributed throughout the areas hit hardest. This has included medical supplies and equipment, hygiene and disaster aid kits, school palpacks, crisis care kits, relief food, and building tools and equipment. Medical teams from Heart to Heart International have been on the ground in conjunction with the church, treating more than 3,000 patients. Work teams from here in the Philippines and from overseas have been partnering in the rebuilding of 9 churches that were completely destroyed. We are also currently working to rebuild more than 500 homes. The number of individual lives impacted through this global response over the past 4 months is truly immeasurable. We know that just in documented cases alone, we have impacted more than 2,780 households. This doesn't even begin to take into account the children impacted through the safe child zones and those touched through the lives of the 135 teachers that have come through our psychosocial training programs and who are now impacting their schools and communities. This will not be a short recovery. By some government estimates, it will take more than 5 years to restore infrastructure and livelihoods. But thanks be to God, the church is strong, growing, and demonstrating the love and compassion of Christ to Nazarene and non-Nazarene communities alike. From our hearts here in the Philippines to yours around the world, maraming salamat po. Thank you for praying, partnering, and paying the price to be the tangible hands and feet of Christ to those in need. Together, we are making a significant kingdom impact.
You're part of that. Isn't that exciting? It's ongoing today. This is a dated image by a few months, but even today we have teams down there. The church is making headway. God is blessing. I want to sort of wrap things up. It's going to take me about another 2 hours to get to the end, but so I better start that way right now. But I want to tell you a little bit about where Connie and I have been feeling God is moving and how God is working in our hearts. And that is Luke chapter 10, verse 5. If you go in there and you look at a story, it starts in Luke chapter 10 where Jesus sent out 72, two by two, to go out in front of him and to start sharing about the kingdom of God. He sent them out and he said, go to a house, speak peace on this house. If your peace is received, stay there with them. Eat what they eat. I hate that it's in there. That means bush rat. Eat what they eat, share with them. And tell them what? The kingdom of God is near. If you go to a house and speak peace on this house and your peace is not received, leave, shake off the dust, tell them it's going to go not so well for you, won't work out real well, but then tell them what? Make sure you tell them the kingdom of God is near. You know, it's this person of peace concept, and it has so radically changed our approach because for years I felt like it's up to us. If we're the missionaries, we've got to have the used car sales pitch down. We've got to have all of our spiritual ducks in a row, and we've got to be able to just really sell this thing. And God started to move on our hearts that, no, it's not. It's not at all about you. You can't do anything. It's about me, and me calling people to myself, and me working in the hearts, and me setting up peace, a person of peace, and you just being there when I call you to be an instrument that I can work through, and to share what? To share the testimony of the hope that he has placed within us. Well, I'll tell you what, when we started studying this, we were in Singapore a year ago in September. And Connie and I said, God, is this where you're really working, or is this just some new tactic of the church as they were teaching us missionaries? And so we said, we're going to put it to the test. And so we decided we would go down. The best place to put it to the test would be on Arab Street in the heart of Singapore down by the mosque. And we were looking for a person of peace. It wasn't necessarily that we were looking for one particular religion, but we figured this would be a good place to see if God was working and there was a person of peace. And let me tell you, it was amazing what happened. I wished I had, because we're recorded, I can't go through all the details. But I can tell you that God was working and teaching us some new strategies of how to share, and God took us to a man we would have never imagined. In fact, we'd stopped to shop. We sort of lost our focus on looking for a person of peace, because in our city, Manila, it's one of the most densely, if not the most densely populated city in the world. I'm going to take a sidebar here, because from the Northwest and Florence, you're going to have a hard time understanding what that looks like. So let me just tell you, in a way you can understand, if you were to take I-5 and take a 30-mile stretch of I-5 and then go out to 99 West East and take about 10 miles at an offset, so if you had a 30-by-10-mile rectangle, and then courtesy of Google and census data, I was able to do some quick research, and you were to take in that 30-by-10-mile rectangle and put all the populations of the states of Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Montana, Wyoming, Colorado, Nevada, and Utah, all of Portland, all of Salem, all of Seattle, all of Salt Lake City, all of Denver, all of Las Vegas, and everything else, and put them in that 30-by-10, that is the city of Manila proper. If you go another 10 miles, you pick up another 10 million people for 37 million people. Wow. Connie went to the doctor 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago now, almost 4 weeks ago, and it was a half-hour doctor's appointment, a half-hour physical therapy, and 11 kilometers to drive in. And she left at about 8 o'clock in the morning and didn't get home until after 9 o'clock at night. Over 12 hours to deal with the traffic and just to get in and out. So we don't go down there much. I'm a guy, and shopping doesn't really excite me anyway. And you add that to it, and I say there is nothing in that city worth 12 hours to go find. We only go if we have to go to the doctor. And so she doesn't get to shop much. And so now we're here on Arab Street, and we stop and turn in and looking at rugs when God brings a person of peace. And he was a person of peace that said, I attend that building right over there. Amazing. God has been starting to show us that when we are praying and seeking where you are working, wow. We start our morning each day, and please understand the light that I share this. I shared this at one church, and somebody came up to me afterwards and said, well, it just sounds like you're trying to toot your own horn. Absolutely not. What I want to share is how God has turned our world upside down, and how we are seeing he is in mission, and we are seeing revival across the nation and in our work in Asia. As we sit and we pray, God, where do you have us to go today? What do you have us to do? And take us there. Let us be not only sensitive, but obedient. And so Connie and I pray in the mornings and say, Lord, where would you have us to go today? And I like to walk in the mornings. And so one morning, a Saturday, about 4 months, 5 months ago, I woke up, and Connie and I are praying early in the morning as we do. And I said, God, would you give me one today? If you're really in this, when I go for my walk, don't let it just be a walk, but give me one. I usually am gone for 1 hour. I came back 4 hours later, and I had writing up my arm. Connie says, what in the world were you doing? I thought you got lost somewhere. I said, honey, I didn't get one. God gave me four people today. The last one was an 80-something-year-old man, and he yelled at me as I was going down the street. He says, yo, Joe! World War II era, if you're white in the Philippines, you're G.I. Joe. So, yo, Joe! I say, yo, what? He says, what you doing out here? I said, well, I work with the church. Oh, you're one of those religious types. I said, no, actually not. Can't stand religion, hate it. I said, in the name of religion, we've slaughtered millions of people around the world. We've set up rules and excluded people from our churches. I don't believe in religion at all. I believe in a relationship with a living Savior. Do you know my Jesus? And I started talking to him about it. Another man I met that morning's name was Willie. Willie, again, was 80-something. I think God is calling me into a new ministry. I'm not sure, but... But he was 80-something, and Willie says, I want you to see my store. So he took me to my store, his store, and when we got there in this area I had never been before, he says, I've got somebody I want you to meet. And he introduced me to a tricycle driver by the name of Jimmy. Jimmy wasn't even one of the four. Jimmy was someone else. Well, Connie and I came to the States from the Philippines. We've been here, this is our third Sunday now, right? So 4 Sundays ago, we found ourselves in an area of the Manila I had never been before, nor would I ever probably go on my own, in a home, Jimmy's home, the tricycle driver, who asked us to come and help celebrate his wife's birthday and invited 25 other people to come and meet us and be part of that. We could never have orchestrated that. In fact, Connie sent me on my own. She said, I don't want to go there. That's scary. And I said, well, it is scary. I said, I'll go, and if it looks good, I'll call you, you know. And so I got into this area, and then they said, well, where's your wife? She has to come too. And I said, well, and I'm trying to make up excuses. I said, well, the party doesn't start till she gets here. So I got on my cell phone. I said, honey, you're being called out. Come on down, you know. We're in Texas, and we were at a motel. We didn't have any place to speak that night, and so we were saying, God, would you give us one? Just give us someone today. Make an ordained appointment, and then let us be sensitive. I walked out. This was the Cherokee. Imagine what this must look like now, about a 1960s vintage motel in the panhandle of Texas. It was called the Cherokee, and you know how they all on one level and parking lot right there. And I walked out of the motel, and a man in the door next to me walked out, 80-plus years old again. His wife had Alzheimer's, and he said, you know, first off, he says, you're not from around here, are you? You know, and I said, I get that everywhere I go, whether it's in Asia, Oregon, they haven't told me that. Thank the Lord. I'm from around here, you know. But I said, no, and he says, what are you doing here? And I said, well, I work with the church. He said, well, what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a missionary. What church? And I told him, Church of Nazarene. He says, you know, the only church I ever remember as a small boy was a Church of the Nazarene. My mom used to take me there. He said, you know, but that's yours now. I've been a scientist. I've worked for NASA. And that's just fairy tales. I'm glad my wife has faith because she's having trouble now and she's got something to believe in, but I could never believe in that. And I'm sitting there, you know, the Lord promises he'll give you the words to speak. And I'm praying while he's telling me his story about this being fairy tales, God, tell me what to share. I had no idea what I could share with a man who is a scientist, 40 years my senior. And God said, share about the disciples. I'm thinking, the disciples? Yes, in my mind, one of the most convincing evidences of a resurrection of a living Savior is the changed lives of the disciples. And so I said, you know, I'm a scientist too. I've been to medical school, and I know it's hard to understand, and it's just, you can't hardly get your mind wrapped around that, but you know, the thing that speaks to me is these young men who followed Jesus, who walked with him, and I said, and there's contemporary literature. I said, you know that there are other articles or other sources that tell this, not just the Bible, that these men walked with him, and right at the end, they all fled. When he went to the cross, when he was killed, they said, we don't want to be any part of this hoax. This thing was bogus. We thought he was going to be the end all, and now he's, you know, and they ran. I said, and then they saw something that so radically changed them that they were willing to come back and go to a martyr's death for what they saw. I said, do you think everybody, all of those guys, would have perpetuated that hoax? And I didn't know where it was going. I didn't know how it was going to resonate with him, but something did. Because he looked at me, and you could just see the wheels turning. He said, maybe one would be crazy enough, but not 11. I said, yeah, not 11. He looks at me and he says, would you pray for me? Wow. Next morning we come out and we're going out to our car again, and he comes up to me as we're packing our car and he says, would you keep praying for me? God is working everywhere around us. And it has become so exciting as we have come to realize it's not about our strategy. It's not about our plan. It's about God is doing it, and we just need to get on board, find out. And I get so excited when I find out you guys are reaching out to the community. We've been at churches that are just isolated. They're in their little box, and they don't want to go out. Well, God didn't call us to stay in the box. You know that party at Jimmy's house? We got there, and there is Jack Daniels and whiskey and all these bottles, and I'm going, oh dear Lord, as they bring out the cameras and start shooting pictures with me, and they're all hanging over me, and I'm like, oh my goodness. You know, I've got my little glass of orange juice there, and I'm thinking, I said, please don't put this on Facebook. I mean, everybody's social media. I said, I'll be fired in a heartbeat, you know, and they're just, it pushed us so far out of our comfort zone. Connie got there, and she's going, I cannot believe you called me into this. I said, I didn't, honey, he did. Here we are, you know, get used to it. God will call us out of our comfort zones. And it's not easy, but he's calling us to be obedient. I'll tell you, just even so recently as 2 weeks ago, we were in Washington, D.C., Dulles. We'd gotten up that morning and had our prayer time again and said, God, we don't speak to anybody. We're just on airplanes today. Would you give us a proper attitude? Would you bring ordained appointments? Would you give us sensitivity? We sat down at the gate at Dulles, and a lady came in and sat down in her chairs right across from us. And as she sat down, her cell phone rang. She picked up the call, and she got the word that her sister had just died. And Connie was able to move right across to her seat, sit down, said, can I pray with you? And guess where she was in this big whole airline, seated? Right across the row from us, or aisle, one row up. And we were able to make her a card while we were flying, and we got some scripture to encourage her and got her bags off and walked off the plane with her. Do you think God is working all around us? Yeah. Folks, we are in an urgent time. As we watch what's happening in the Middle East and Asia, we see prophecy literally being fulfilled. It is exciting time to be a Christian. And when is there a greater time than in the midst of crisis and change and uncertainty than to now to share the hope that God has put within us? Exciting. I want Connie to come share. We've got a few minutes left, about an hour and a half. Connie's going to share from the heart of a mom and then sing us a song.
We could do that. If you go out to our table out there, you will see a picture of our family. Our girls look just like me, and the boys look like their daddy. Their biological daddy, that is. The boys were adopted in Micronesia, where we had our second child. We left for the mission field with a 17-month-old baby, and I had a baby over there. Her name is Tamalayel. Isn't that pretty? Tamalayel, literally translated, it means that her father was not present at her birth. He was gone flying. And not only was he gone flying, he took the only American doctor with him. Oh. 2 weeks before I had this baby, I cried an entire night. You know, women, hormones. An entire night. Said, honey, women die having babies. Promise me that if you are in an airplane and I go into labor, that you will turn around and come back. You won't continue and drop your passengers and pick up your freight. You will just turn around and come back. I need you. I can't do this. I don't have any other family. I need you here. He promised. Then the day I went into labor, I was at the hospital waiting for the doctor to sign some papers so we could stay on the island for another year. Doctor came out after several hours of surgery, saw me and said, where's your husband? I need a medical evacuation. I said, you can't have him, I'm in labor. He said, if this boy does not get to the trauma center in Guam, he will die. I had a quick talk with God. I said, God, you know I can't do this on my own. And God said, you're right, you can't. But I can. I didn't tell Todd, that I was in labor until I handed him the last oxygen tank into his airplane, and he said, hop in. No, I don't want to have a baby in an airplane, thank you. But God gave me a peace that evening. Went to the hospital, had the baby. They wiped her off with a half of a beach towel, tied her belly button with a piece of string, handed her to me, and we were done. God gave me a peace, and I have pictures to prove that I had a smile on my face the entire delivery. Something I did not have with the first child. God gave me what I needed when I needed it. Not 2 weeks before, not even 5 minutes before, but when I needed it, God gave me what I need. Kids, where was Jesus? In the boat. Jesus was right there with me when I needed him. Fast forward, now we are in Africa. There are grenades going over our home. You can hear the whine and the explosion. That's a little bit scary. God gave me what I needed when I needed it. We have these wonderful things called coup days. Kind of like a snow day around here. A coup day is when the bombs start falling and you get that 5 o'clock a.m. phone call that schools are canceled, stay in, there are problems in the street. God gave us some wisdom that is beyond us. And we called it a coup day. We would close up all of the doors and windows in the house. We lived in the tropics, so everything was typically open. We'd close everything and turn on a movie. We'd turn on the air conditioner, something that we don't hardly ever use because it's expensive. But the air conditioner and the movie and the closed doors muffled the noises outside. My kids thought it was the greatest thing in the world. They thought coup days were awesome. Dad typically stayed home, something that he didn't get to do very often. And we had family time. God gave us what we needed when we needed it. Fast forward, now we're in the Philippines. Typhoon Haiyan is coming. And they're telling us this is going to be the strongest one we've ever seen. God gave us a peace. Now, it did not hit in Manila where we live. It hit in the central Visayas region. We've had other typhoons that hit us. But God gives us the strength. And I know that he will continue to do that. And I know that he can do the same thing for you. Because where's Jesus, kids? In the boat. In our Sunday school class, we talked about when Jesus said, let's go across the Sea of Galilee. And the big storm came up, and then he calmed the wind and the waves. He was in the boat while that was all happening. He's in the boat. And he will continue to be that way. You want to go ahead?
Yeah, I need some ushers. Real quick, let's go. We're going to take a love offering for Todd and Connie. Folks, when you give above and beyond your tithe to Faith Promise, this is where it goes. This is what it's doing. It's doing disaster relief like you saw in the videos. When we take special offerings, and I try really hard not to special offering you to death, because I know we can go too far with that. But when we take special offerings, that's where it's going, to places like the Philippines. We have an obligation, folks. I'm just going to say it bluntly. We have a responsibility and an obligation. We have been given much, generally speaking. We have an obligation to help those who have much less. That's just the way it is. Father, thank you for Todd and Connie and the wonderful things they've shared today. You are moving in powerful ways around the world, and we just want to give this love offering just because we love them, and we love the church, and we love missions, and we love being a part of an international team that's making things happen around the world. Just bless it, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
As little kids, did you ever sing that song, This Little Light of Mine? Yes. And did you use hand motions?
Yes.
And how did you do that? Is it down here? It was up here, right?
Right.
And you say, hide it under a bushel?
No.
Exactly. I like this church. This song is about that. There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning and some dark and cold. There is a spirit who breathes a fire, ignites the candle and makes its home. Carry your candle, run to the dark.
Thank you so much for welcoming us in your church, for doing a deputation offering. Some people come up and ask afterwards, what is that used for? Is that for your pizza fund or what? And I like to just give you confidence that with the tax laws and IRS requirements that goes to the general treasurer, and we have to apply to use it to repair our vehicle, or if I'm buying equipment to go down in the disaster zone, I can request funds to be used. And so that's what that's for. And so thank you so much. But even more so than deputation are these prayer cards. We so believe in the power of prayer. Folks, our ministry will fail without people that pray and come behind us and support us in this way. I've got one little story. Imagine that, another story. But I was going into a country, and I had my suitcases full of Jesus film equipment. I had DVDs, oral readers. I had Evangel cubes. And as I got close, 2 hours from landing, they handed out the customs documents, and it says, do you have any weapons? No. Do you have any drugs? No. Do you have any? No. No. Do you have any evangelistic materials, DVDs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? I said, oh, man, my luggage is full of this. You know, you'd think for a Christian missionary it would be easy to just mark yes and say, okay, we're going to go in there. And I wasn't able to take my pen out and finally mark yes until I was standing up. And I said, okay, God, I really want to go home and see my kids, but I don't want to have stuff found in my luggage and then have no on my form and be said, well, what kind of a Christian are you if you lie on your documents? And so I said, okay, God, I will mark yes, and then it's up to you. If you want me to have a prison ministry like Paul from the inside out, and so be it. You know, and I walk into that airport, and they have the customs line. There's the red line and the green line. And the green line, everybody goes free. They just hand your paper when you walk. And the red line, everything in your suit gets checked. And there's a military guy in the middle, and he just arbitrarily points red, green, red, red, green, green, green. He looks at me, and I'm back there going, green line, green line, green line. He looks at me, and he goes, red line. I said, okay, God. So we get close, there's about four people in front of me in the inspection line, and then there's three, then there's just one lady in front of me. And I'm sweating and I'm praying, and all of a sudden the lady in front of me decides it's an appropriate time to get in fight with the customs agent. She rips open her suitcase and out comes this red pair of lingerie, like, you know, I'm embarrassed to see them. And then a yellow pair, and an orange pair, and on. And this poor customs officer is so embarrassed that he just wants all of this to just go away right now, because the line's starting to stack. He reaches past her, he grabs my forms, and he says, just go, go. I had no idea that God used angels and lingerie. But folks, he answers prayer. So grab one of these and please put it somewhere prominent and commit to, thank you, pray for us. Yes, I know what I'm doing. We have a sign-up sheet back there that has email on it, and if you put your email, we send out urgent updates. If you want to find out what's going on, and if we've got somebody sick, or we're telling you what, you know, a ministry thing that's happening, you can sign up for that, and you'll get those updates. And that's just about it. I promised you 4 or 5 hours, but I'm going to be sensitive, so you don't throw anything at me. But is there anything we forgot today? Did we miss anything? Which story?